Good afternoon, students. Today we are going to continue the last session, which is addressing modes. So we have seen that the addressing modes are of means different types of addressing modes which are going to be supported by the 8086 microprocessor, like immediate addressing mode, register addressing mode, memory addressing mode. Under the memory addressing mode, we have seen five different types. One is the direct addressing mode, next one is the register indirect addressing mode, next one is the based addressing mode, indexed addressing mode. And the last one under the memory addressing modes are based indexed addressing mode. The last session, we concluded the based indexed addressing mode. So in the today's session, we are going to continue the addressing modes, and we left only with one type of addressing mode, which is nothing but the port addressing mode. We'll finish it off that one in the today's class. Okay. So let me take the transition and go to the view, right? Yeah, so today we are going to discuss about the last addressing mode, which is nothing but the port addressing mode, What exactly the port addressing mode is a question. So before that, let us define what exactly the port. Port is nothing but the end point beyond which we can't move. So whenever you would like to interface your device to the system, like your personal computer or the laptop, or anything, or otherwise nowadays you are having the USB and you can connect your USB to the phone devices also. Okay, now whenever you are trying to connect your device like USB or phone or whatever it is, any electronic gadget, to the personal computer, you are going to use the USB slot. So that area is called as a port. Port is nothing but the end point beyond which we can't move. That is called as a port. So in this case, in the present class, we are going to discuss about the port addressing mode. What exactly the port addressing mode means? What is the use of the port addressing mode is a question. Okay, now. So port addressing mode means how to read the data from the input device, or how to write the data from the microprocessor onto the output device. From the microprocessor onto the output device. So whenever you would like to interface any kind of input device or output device, let us take one simple diagram for the explanation point of view. I'm going to take a simple diagram. So assume that this is my personal computer, and this is my one of the input device, and this one is going to be one of the output device. Now what I'm going to do is, I would like to interface. So this I call it as the input device, right? So let me take it as an input. I/P I'm going to use, which indicates the input device, and I'm going to use the O/P, which indicates the output device. Okay, now in short, I'm just using the input and the output device representation. So here we are having the input device, and here we are having the output device, and this is a microprocessor, right? So let me take this one as an MP, right? MP. This is my microprocessor. Now, so here means it is a microprocessor based system, means all the components are there. Assume that this entire thing is one board, the microprocessor based board. So now when you would like to interface input device to the microprocessor based board, then obviously you are going to have some connecting point. So this is a connecting point for the input device. This is a connecting point for the output device. One is for the input device, another one is the output device. Okay, now. So these two are the connecting point. Now, when you would like to receive the data, let us suppose I would like to read the data from the input device into the microprocessor. Remember, having the port is nothing but means whenever we are having one port to connect the input device or output device on the microprocessor based system or on your phone. Nowadays, you are having the USB and you are going to use the OTG USB to interface to your phone as an external memory device. And any kind of device, input-output device, which is going to be used as a, storage device. Okay, now. When you would like to connect one device to your microprocessor-based system, at that time, whatever the device you would like to connect to your microprocessor-based system, that device is going to be identified by your microprocessor based on the address, that to which address, the address which is allocated for this particular port. If you are trying to connect your input device to the microprocessor, then the microprocessor is going to be identifies your input device only based on the address which is allocated to this particular block, which is allocated to this particular port. In simple format, this particular port. Okay. So each port, each and every port which is there on the microprocessor based board, that is going to be identified by the microprocessor with their addresses. Again, I'm repeating. Each and every port which is there on the microprocessor board, that is going to be identified by the microprocessor with their addresses. For example, you people are going to be recognized by the university, in the uniform way. If I'm going to say that in the uniform way, means irrespective of the names. Let us suppose some of you may have the, means most of you may have the common names, differentiated with the surnames. Sometimes the surname might be the same. Okay, now. D something so and so. Okay, now. D something so and so or B something so and so. Okay. So, means the many people may have the same names. In order to differentiate them, what they are going to do means they are going to assign the roll numbers. Means university people are going to be recognize you based on the roll numbers. If at all there is a common names among the multiple people, then they are going to identify you people based on your roll number. Okay, nice. So in our classroom also, I think we are running. It is not the thing. Actually, we are running in the virtual classes. So that's why I'm unable to remember your names. I'm sorry. I erased everything. Okay. So that's why I'm unable to remember your names. Because I don't know you people. But I need your addresses. Means mostly till the last batch, I'm going to identify the students based on their roll number, not based on their names. Okay. So here the roll number means every device. It is just like a roll number what you are having. Just like that, every device which is interfaced to the microprocessor based system, that is going to be identified by the microprocessor with its address. That address is nothing but to which it is connected. So here we are having the port now. So here I'm assuming that this is a port for my input device and this port is having some address. So here I'm assuming that this is the port which is used for interfacing the output device. So this is for input device. I/P and input device, and this one is going to be the output device, right? We are having the input device as well as we are having the output device. Input device is there, output device is there. I'm assuming that this port is going to be used by my system. Okay, now. So means the input device is connected to my microprocessor based system. That is nothing but the to my microprocessor board using this particular port. Now this port is going to be identified, means whatever the device which is interfaced to this particular port, that is going to be identified by the microprocessor. This input device is going to be identified by the microprocessor based on the address assigned to this particular device. What is the address assigned to this particular port? Actually, this is a port acting as an input. So how we are going to assign the addresses? If you are following the regular classes, once we come across the interfacing block diagrams, then we can easily assign our own address to our particular port. You can assign your own address to a particular device to whom you would like to talk. Okay. So means addresses are going to be assigned by the developers only who are going to design your interfacing system. So they are designed whenever we are taking the personal computer, we are having the ports, and those ports are assigned with certain addresses, and your device is going to be identified by the microprocessor using that particular address only. Now, if you want to read the data from the input device into the microprocessor based system, I'm not going to the personal computer right now. I'm just specific to the microprocessor based system. Okay. So if you want to read the data, first what you are supposed to do, you are supposed to know the address of this particular port, because the input device is connected to this particular input port. Okay. So let us suppose, in order to read the data, the syntax is, what is the instruction is, the instruction in instruction is going to be used to read the data. And to write the data, out instruction is going to be used. Again, I'm saying that every device which is interfaced to the microprocessor, that is going to be identified with their addresses. That is the port addresses. Not only that, whatever the ICs you would have seen in your microprocessor-based systems, microprocessor-based boards in your 8085 microprocessor on all those things, all those ICs are going to be identified by the microprocessor based on their addresses, not based on their names. Remember that one. Everything is going to be in the address format. So when you would like to read the data from the input device, into the microprocessor, then in instruction is going to be used. So if you want to know the syntax, one more point I would like to tell. When you want to read the data from the input device into the microprocessor, that should be done via the accumulator. Let me take this one. Set to accumulator lower byte. As I said, we are having a specific functionality to the accumulator lower byte. Okay, now. So this one means from the input device, the data is going to be loaded into the accumulator, from the accumulator into the microprocessor, to which you would like to, means to where you would like to store the information, whatever the memory location you are having. If you want to store that information into that particular specified memory location, then first it should be loaded into the accumulator, from the accumulator to the microprocessor. Now the question comes that in order to read the data from the input device, which is connected to this particular port, how we are going to use the in instruction. Okay, now. So as I said, again, if you want to read the data from the input device into the accumulator, mediator is what? Middle person is what? The input port address. So let us suppose the address of this particular port, I am assuming that address of this particular port is a 06H. So means, let us suppose I would like to read the data into the microprocessor. For that, I'm going to use the instruction, which is nothing but the in instruction. In space, AL, 06H. What exactly the meaning of this one? So we are asking the microprocessor to read the data from the 06H address. So now I'm fixing this address, this particular input port address as a 06. Now this particular address, which is assigned for the input to this particular port as an input port, using this particular address, microprocessor is going to produce the data and stores that information into the accumulator. And one more point I would like to say that this kind of addressing mode is called as a fixed type port addressing mode. Means the address written over here, it is not going to be variable one, because it is not the register, right? Okay, now. So it is going to be the fixed type addressing mode. Now, here if you see the 06, it is a 8-bit address. Means I am assigning the address to this particular port as a 8-bit address. I may have the 16-bit address to a particular port. What I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite the same instruction by converting the 06, which is in the 8-bit format, into the 16-bit format by taking the 0006H. So means int in, when you would like to read the data from a particular port whose address is a 16-bit wire, that address first, it should be that address, whatever the address which is a 16-bit wire, that address first, it should be loaded into the, what is that? DX register. Means I'm assuming that 0006H is my address. 0006H is my address. Means now this particular port address, I'm fixing that one as a 16-bit address, not the 8-bit. This is the 8-bit notation. In the 8-bit notation, I can directly specify the 8-bit address as a part of the instruction. But when we are having the 16-bit address to a particular port, then that address should be first loaded into the DX register. And after that, I'm going to make use of this DX register as in space AL, DX. Okay, now. So in the previous case, if you see this one, this particular case, in this case, 06 is a 8-bit address. Okay, but in this case, 0006H. is a 16-bit address. When we are having the 16-bit address to a particular port, that 16-bit address should be taken as a data into the DX register, and we are going to use the in space AL comma DX. Now you may ask me one question, sir. Both registers are not of same size. Remember, ma, here we are saying that we are reading the data from the input device into the microprocessor through the accumulator using the 8-bit data notation. Using the 8-bit data notation means AL is specifying that the microprocessor is reading the 8-bit data. But whatever the DX we are having over here, now this particular DX is showing the address of the port. Means DX is not showing the data. DX is showing the address of the input port. AL is reading the data which is there on this particular address. Don't get confused. Okay. So if it is the 8-bit address, if the port address is the 8-bit address like this, then I'm going to write the address directly. If it is a 16-bit one, then that particular 16-bit address should be first loaded into the DX register and make use of the in space AL, DX. Means I'm going to make use of the DX content. If you are writing the in space like this, what I'm having down there, I'm just rewriting that one. So if you are having the in AL comma DX, meaning of that one is take the DX content as an address, and that address, from that address, read the data into the AL register. So using this kind of instruction, we are reading the data. Let us suppose I would like to write the data onto the output device. So when you would like to write the data onto the output device, then what you are going to do means you are going to make use of the out instruction. I am simply using the out instruction. Okay. Now. So here in this out instruction, what you are supposed to do? In the out instruction, here we are supposed to write the data from the microprocessor onto the output device. I am assuming this one is an output device. Okay. Now. And I'm assuming this one is a microprocessor. It is going to be the microprocessor, right? Now, I would like to rewrite the data from the microprocessor onto the output device. So, writing the data from the microprocessor onto the output device is nothing but writing the data onto the port, that is the output port to which the output device is connected. I'm assuming the address assigned to this particular port is a simple one. I'm just assuming it as a 5000H. I would like to write the data onto the output device. Which is connected to the a particular output port. And I'm assuming that port address is a 5000H. At that time, as we know that out instruction is used for to write the data onto the output device. Now, and one more thing is, whenever you would like to write the data onto the output device, again, that writing the data should be done via the accumulator. First of all, I'm going to take the, as it is a 16-bit address, as the output port address is a 16-bit, which is a 5000H, this is the output port address. So I'm first taking that one into the DX register. So move. I'm taking the output port address as a data into the DX register. Move 5000H. Okay, now move DX comma 5000H means what exactly the meaning of this one? 5000H, treat the 5000H as a data. Store that one into the DX register. After that, we are going to use the DX content. It is just like a indirect addressing mode of operation. I'm going to use the DX content as an address and I'm going to write the data. So for that, the instruction is I'm going to write the data onto the output device out DX comma A. So in this case, who is the source? Microprocessor is trying to send the information. So the data should be transferred from the microprocessor into the AL, from the AL into the onto the output device. So because of that, I'm assuming that AL is having the data, and in order to write the AL data onto the output output device, which is connected to the 5000H memory address, I'm simply writing the out space DX comma AL. So means the data available in the AL is going to be written onto the address specified by the DX register, and to this particular address, which is connected, the output device is connected to this particular device. Okay, the output device is connected to output device is connected to this particular address. Okay, so this is what we are having. Port addressing mode is nothing but when you would like to read the data from the input device into the microprocessor or from the output device from the when you would like to read the data from the input device into the microprocessor, and when you would like to write the data from the microprocessor onto the output device, it should be done via the accumulator. And in this particular addressing mode, we are going to make use of the two instructions. One is the in instruction and another one is the out instruction. We are going to make use of the two instructions. One is the in instruction and another one is the out instruction. Okay, now. So port addressing mode is nothing but the devices which are connected to the port. Whenever you would like to read the data from those devices which are connected to the port, then we are using the port addressing mode. And port addressing mode, when you are going through the textbook, don't worry about it. I am going to send the snaps of these topics in the upcoming classes. Don't worry about it. I am going to share that information in the group. Okay. So port addressing mode means whenever you would like to read the data from the input device into the microprocessor, output device from the microprocessor onto the output device, it should be done via the accumulator. Again, I am repeating that the whatever the devices which are there in your which are interfaced to your personal computer or whatever the ICs which are there on your motherboard and all those things are going to be identified by the microprocessor with their addresses. Address assigned to a device may be the 8-bit address. Address assigned to a device to the may be the 16-bit device. That purely depends on what kind of interfacing diagram you are using. Okay. Now. So we'll see all those things. I think almost at the just before finishing the first unit, we are going to learn that how to interface the input port to the microprocessor, how to interface the output port to the microprocessor, and how we can assign the address to that particular port. Remember, ma, we are going to assign our own addresses. No need to buy hard anything from the textbook. But if you are having the thorough knowledge, then you can draw your own diagram, own interfacing diagram, and you can assign your own address. But if you are getting confused with that one, then you are supposed to do more practice and remember the textbook diagram. Okay, now you are supposed to do more practice on the diagrams. Okay, so just remember that when you would like to interface your input device to the microprocessor and output device to the microprocessor, that should be done via the port. So we are going to have the port address. Okay, so your devices are going to be identified by the microprocessor using the port addresses. Okay, now. So this is all about our the addressing modes. So let us review one more time. Addressing modes. So how to write in the exam? So addressing modes means if you are getting one question, define the addressing mode and explain the addressing mode supported by the 8086 microprocessor in detail with some examples. So we have seen the examples under each and every addressing mode now. So just write them. Otherwise, while go through in your textbook, whatever the examples you are having, you just explain them. But for every addressing mode, just explain one or two addressing mode, two examples. Don't go for writing all the instructions which are going to be used in your textbook. Okay, now one or two instructions more than enough, because while writing the exam, it is going to be take more and more time. Okay, now. So that's why the definition of each addressing mode should be defined in the perfect way, and after that give the one or two examples. Don't give more than two examples as per my knowledge. But if you are having the more instructions in the instruction set, we'll come to that one, don't worry. But for under each addressing mode, so just use one or two instructions to explain that concept. Okay, so if at all you got the question like this, define an addressing mode and explain the addressing modes which are supported by the 8086 microprocessor in detail or with examples, then the definition is going to be addressing mode is nothing but the number of ways that are used to represent the location of the data. Location of the data is called as a addressing mode. Okay, now. So here we are having the different types of addressing mode. Throughout the addressing modes explanation, we took the move in syntax only, move instruction as an example for explaining the addressing modes in 8086. So here immediate addressing mode is nothing but one of the operand is a means source operand is a constant value, that may be the 8-bit or the 16-bit value, and the destination is going to be the any register or the memory location, whatever it is, but both should not be the memory, as we know that one. So immediate addressing mode. Register addressing mode means in this case both operands, source and the destination, both operands are the registers and both should be of same size. Memory addressing mode means under the memory addressing mode, we will discuss the direct addressing mode. Direct addressing mode means in an instruction, either the source or the destination is going to be the memory location, and the other one is going to be the register or any other thing. But both operands should not be the memory locations. We have seen that address, direct addressing mode also. So the next one is the register indirect addressing mode. Register indirect addressing mode means one of the register content is used as a address. That is nothing but the offset address. We have seen that one. In order to perform the register indirect addressing mode, the registers which are going to be used are base registers like BX, BP, index register like SI and DI. Okay. Now. So if we are using only the base register, then it is called as a base addressing mode. If we are using the index register, then it is called as a indexed addressing mode. If we are using both the base and index register, then it is called as a based indexed addressing mode, which we have discussed in the last session. So the next case is a port addressing mode. Port addressing mode means in order to read the data from a particular port and in order to write the data onto a particular port by the microprocessor, for that we are having the port addressing mode. But as I explained, that every device is going to be interfaced to the microprocessor using the particular port. That port may be the input port or that port may be the output port. And another case is the port address may be the 8-bit address or it may be the 16-bit address. That purely depends on your interfacing diagram. Okay. Now. So this is all about your addressing modes. Okay. So if you are having any queries regarding the addressing modes, let me know in the WhatsApp group. Okay. So now what we do is I'll just define the instruction set of the instruction. And means the next topic, what I'm going to cover is a instruction set of the 8086 microprocessor. Okay, so what exactly the instruction set of 8086 microprocessor? So means what are the instructions which are going to be supported by the 8086 microprocessor? All of them together forming as a one set. So it is called as an instruction set. But what exactly the instruction is the question? Okay, now. So instruction is nothing but, as per my knowledge, I'm always defining the definition of the instruction like this. Instruction is nothing but it is a binary information given to a microprocessor to perform a particular operation. Okay, now. Why I'm saying the binary information? Binary means microprocessor is always realizes the concepts, realizes the instructions in the binary form, not in the hexadecimal form. We are storing the instructions in the memory in the hexadecimal form. We are storing the data in the memory in the hexadecimal form. But in order to process that data or in order to process the instruction by the microprocessor, it should be converted into the binary format, not in the hexadecimal format. So that's why my definition for the addressing mode is, instruction is what exactly the instruction means. It is nothing but, otherwise instruction is nothing but, it is nothing but a binary information. Given to a microprocessor. MP is nothing but the microprocessor to perform a specific operation. So instruction is nothing but it is a binary information given to a microprocessor to perform a specific operation. Okay. So this is a definition of instruction. You will get the question like this. Define an instruction and explain the instruction set of the 8086 microprocessor in detail. Okay. So instruction is nothing but it is a binary information given to a microprocessor to perform a specific operation. Okay. So now let us define. Let us go back to our instruction set of the 8086 microprocessor. Depending on the type of the operation which are going to be supported by the instructions, in 8086 microprocessor, they are classified into like this. They are divided like this. Okay. So one is the data transfer instruction. First one is going to be the data transfer instruction. Second one is going to be the arithmetic instructions. Third one is going to be the bit manipulation instructions. Fourth one is the string instructions, branch control instructions, iteration control instructions, interrupt instructions, process control instructions. Okay. So the instructions which are going to be supported by the 8086 microprocessor are divided into different types which are there on the screen based on their operation. Okay. So data transfer instructions means move instructions. They are going to transfer the data. They are not modifying any kind of operand, any kind of register content. They are simply copying the data from one location to another location. So that's why it is called as a data transfer instruction. Syntax examples for this one, we are going to see in detail explanation of the data transfer instructions in the next coming video. Don't worry about it. But the data transfer instruction is nothing but which transfers the information from one location to another location without changing the content. Examples are the, we have the move instruction, we have the exchange instruction, we have the translating instruction, we have the push instruction, we have the pop instruction. All those instructions are comes under the data transfer instruction. Don't worry about it. We are going to see in detail explanation for each and every instruction which is there in the instruction set of the 8086 microprocessor. Arithmetic instructions are nothing but which performs the arithmetic operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. Okay, now in 8085 microprocessor, we don't have the multiplication division instructions, but in case of the 8086 microprocessor, we do have the multiplication and division instructions, which is going to be the advantage for the 8086 microprocessor compared to the 8085. So the next one is the bit manipulation instructions. Bit manipulation instructions means like logical instructions, which are nothing but the AND operation, OR operation, OR NOT operation. And rotate instructions also comes under the bit manipulation. Shift instructions also come under the bit manipulation instructions. The next one is the string instructions. In order to perform the string related operations, means to concat the strings or to accept the string or to store the string. For everything, we are having the string manipulation instructions. We are going to see that one also. Branch control instructions means in order to diverting the execution control from one location to another location, either by checking the condition or without checking the condition. Because by checking condition is called as a conditional branch instruction, without checking any condition is called as a unconditional branch instruction. Means branch control instructions are further classified into two types, conditional and unconditional. We'll see that one, no problem. Iteration control instructions are nothing but the looping instructions, just like your for loop. Iteration control instructions are nothing but the loop instructions, just like your for loop and for loop, dual loop, how you are using to perform that kind of operation. We are having the iteration control instructions. Next one is the interrupt instruction. Interrupt instructions are nothing but here when you would like to interrupt the microprocessor. Let us define the interrupt actually. Interrupt is nothing but it is a request coming from the external world to the microprocessor. Otherwise, if at all we are in the physical classroom, physically we are there in the classroom and I'm giving the lecture. So in the middle of the lecture, if someone knocked the door at the doorstep, then obviously it is going to be the interrupt. Obviously it is going to be the interrupt. Interrupt is nothing but it is a request coming from the external world to the microprocessor. Okay. No? So that request is maybe processed by the microprocessor, may not be processed by the microprocessor. That purely depends on the type of the interrupt which is coming from the external source. Okay, so that we are going to see in detail when we come across the interrupt instructions. So next one is the process control instructions, which are going to be used by the processor to set the carry flag and to clear the carry flag and complement the carry flag. All those things operations are going to be performed by the process control instructions. Okay, now so this is the instruction set of your 8086 microprocessor in brief. In the next class, we are going to see in detail about the instruction set of the 8086 microprocessor. Okay, now so that's all for today's class. If you are having any queries regarding the addressing modes and I just started the instruction set. I think you don't have any question from the instruction set, but if you are having any doubts regarding the addressing modes in 8086 microprocessor, then let me know that one in the group. Okay, thank you. So that's all for today's class. We'll continue in the next class with other explanation. Thank you.